Hi team, welcome to session 11, Administration with Secure Shell and Secure Copy, SCP and SSH. This is Linux Essential Series. What you will learn in this session is with the demonstration, introduction to SSH, configuring SSH client, command line access, SSH command line tools, graphical secure shell access. So first we would like to see the demonstration of it. So let me share my screen. Now I'm sharing my screen. Hope you will be able to see this now. Now before I proceed, I would like to show you I have two machines. One is controller. Take a look at. I'm logged in on controller machine as root user. Second machine is compute. This is my compute machine. I'm logged in as root user. When you use IP space A command, IP space A, it will give you the IP addresses. So if you take a look at closely, I have two Ethernet cards, ENP0S3 and ENP0S8. The ENP0S3 have IP address 10.0.2.15 and ENP0S8 has the IP address 10.0.0.31. Same thing I can show you on my controller machine, IP space A. Now here also if you look at, you will see something same, ENP0S8 and IP address is 10.0.0.11. So this is the IP address. From where these IP addresses are coming? Mind it, the IP address of series 10.0.2.15 means IP address of series 10.0.2. This series IP address is allowing this virtual machine to connect to the internet because of this region. If you look at here, these are my four machines. Earlier I've been giving demonstration on server 1, but today I would like to introduce two more machines just to show you the connectivity between the machines. So the two IP addresses, like this is third machine is not started yet, but I can show you the settings. They are similar. So go to the network setting. The first adapter is NAT. When you enable this as NAT out of so many options available, that means you will be able to connect to internet from this machine. So one way traffic, and you will be able to download and install software on this machine once you enable this. Second was host only adapter. The host only adapter is basically to connect this machine among themselves, among internally, plus also from your host machine. The host machine means the Windows machine or the MacBook. Internally they will be able to connect, plus you will be able to connect from the Windows machine also, which I will show you just now. Okay, this is host only adapter, and this adapter has the IP address of the series 10.0.0.11, 10.0.0.31. Alright. And that is why I'm working on this machine now. And to connect from Windows, I have a tool. That tool is called PuTTY, P-U-T-T-Y. You can download PuTTY for Mac also. You can download PuTTY for Windows also to connect machines, Linux machines to be precise. So I use PuTTY to connect, and let me exit and show you again. When you start PuTTY, you'll get this kind of interface. So I have configured multiple systems to connect from PuTTY, so you can save connections. So this is my controller. I can type the IP address here, 10 dot, for example, 10.0.0.11. That was the IP address of my controller, port number 22, which is SSH. You see SSH is selected here, SSH port number 22, and I click open and it will try to connect to that, and I'm getting the login prompt. This login prompt is coming from controller, and I can let me increase the font size so that you can see this in a better way. Change settings, appearance, and I can increase the font size so that it becomes perfectly visible. So let me make it 14 font size. Yes, now I can log in as root Red Hat. Now I'm logged in on the controller. So this is SSH connection. Again, how it is happening? Let me take you to the controller machine and show you how it is happening. This is my controller machine. This is happening because my service SSHD service status SSHD. This service is running. Had it not been running, I would not have been able to connect. Because it is running, I am able to connect. By default, this service is always started and enabled. By default means when you install Linux for the first time, you don't have to do any configuration for this service in order to connect, in order to allow other machines to connect. Now from this machine, if I want to connect other machines, like I want to connect from this machine, from the controller machine, I want to connect the compute machine. So I first need to verify the IP address connectivity, ping 10.0.0. IP address of the compute machine was 31, if you recollect. So I'll first try ping command to verify the connectivity. So I see the connectivity is there. Now I try SSH 10.0.0.31. When I specify this, that means whatever username I have here, root name, right? I'm logged in as root here. So it will try to connect that machine as root user only. Had it not been root, if I want to try some other user, I can specify the username here, stack at the rate 10.0.0.31. That means I want to connect to this machine 10.0.0.31 as stack user, right? I want to access that machine. So let me try as root user only. So SSH 10.0.0.31. When you connect for the first time, it will ask you some verification that there's a private key negotiation, and it will display that key with the ID and the continuity. So the warning: are you sure you want to continue connecting this? And when you say yes, it will ask you the password. So I specify the password of that machine and I'm connected to this machine compute. You see, I'm connected to the compute machine now. Now I'm working on compute machine. Very good thing, I was working on controller machine. On the same, I'm working right now on the compute machine. I can do whatever I want on the compute machine now. This is my compute machine. So let me create a file, touch, let's say first file. If I want to copy this file to the controller machine, I'm working on compute, remember, I'm working on compute machine. I want to copy this file to controller machine. I can do that. For that, I have the command scp, secure copy. The file name, where I want to copy, IP address of the machine, 10.0.0.11. This was the IP address of controller machine, if you remember correctly, :// where I want to copy, single slash, root/, under root directory I want to copy it. Now from here, now it is again I'm copying back to the controller machine. So 10.0.0.11 root machine, and it is asking again because you are trying to connect from compute to controller for the first time. So we can do that. Yes, I specify the password and it will copy. Now I can close this connection. Back, connection is closed. Now I'm back to my controller machine. I can see the file is here available. You can see the file is available here. Let's do more. I want to copy this file keystone.sh to the file compute from controller machine. Remember, I'm working on controller machine now because I have closed the connection. I'm working on this controller machine now. From controller to compute, I want to copy. So command is scp keystone.sh, the file name. IP address of the machine 10.0.0.31 :// the directory where you want to copy, and it is asking for the password. Now it is not giving me that warning because you have already connected once. When you try to connect for the first time, only then it will show you that warning. When you was in subsequent connections, you will not get that warning. Warning will be displayed only once. Now, if I connect to the compute again 10.0.0.31, okay, now again you notice that the warning is not displayed and you are directly connected. You use ls command, keystone.sh file is copied here. So remote copy works like this. You can use scp secure copy to copy file across the systems if you are able to reach them, if your networking is properly configured. SCP. SSH is to take control, to take shell of the remote system, to manage the system effectively, and that's how I manage my servers. So where the settings are, if you go to, whenever you connect for the first time, a directory is created in your home directory. All right. And if I use ls-al, there is a directory .ssh. That directory will be created whenever you do it for the first time, and this is created today itself. Alright, this directory is created. Under this directory, two files are you'll find 2-3 files. Let me go and check the file cd.ssh. This is automatically created. I'm just showing the environment. When you try to connect to the remote machine for the first time and you see that warning, once you accept that, the entry of that machine are made in this file. So you can take a look at known host, and this is what that entry was. You see the IP address of the machine and the key, which is secure key, which is a key which is required to connect. So these entries are made here automatically, so that subsequent connection you don't have to do every time this negotiation. So this happens from where these settings are there. Let me connect again. This time I will connect to compute from here, compute load, and I'll connect with compute. Let me first change the settings so that the font size is a little big and we can access it. Alright, so connecting to root, Red Hat. This is my compute this time. I'm connected to root. This is also SSH connection only. Alright, this is also SSH connection. Where these client connection settings are, these settings are under the file etc SSH SSH underscore config. This is client connection. Client means the machine from where you are connecting. Server means to which you are connecting. So I'm talking about from where. From this machine I'm going to connect. The settings which will affect this are stored into this SSH underscore config. Okay. And first uncommented line is here. Host star. In fact, there's a better approach which I discussed in the previous session, the regular expression. Let's use the power of grep to show only uncommented line from this file. So grep hyphen o, as usual I talked about this, caret symbol slash line not beginning with hash followed by star means any character, any number of characters, and then slash etc slash ssh slash ssh underscore config, and only these lines are uncommented lines in that file. Rest all were comments. So one notice that you see the first uncommented line is host star, means connect to any host, means you are allowed to connect to any host from this machine. GSS API authentication is yes. This is secure authentication. Forward X11 yes. X11 means Windows GUI forwarding. That means if you want to issue some GUI commands on the remote machine, that will be allowed from this machine. That happens with hyphen X option. And then we have some environment variables. You may ask, you do we need to change them? Never. Have you ever changed them? I have never done that. So why we are seeing them? Just to understand the environment. That's it. You will never be working with these environment variables, to my understanding. In case, just in case you require, you should know where the environment variables are set. And second thing is the SSH D underscore config. This is the server. Means if other machines try to connect to this machine, then what this machine is allowing. This machine settings are given in underscore sshd underscore config file. So let's take a look at those settings also. So those settings are host key, right? The keys allowed, signature, authority, authorization key files, where the file will be stored. This is the file where the settings are stored. Password authentication allowed, yes, right? So these are the detailed settings about the server. You don't have to make any changes into this also. However, in my case, I have made some changes into this file. Let me show you what we can do. Let's take a look at this file. Let's make one good setting about this file, vi. And here you see the port number given. Just as an example, I will talk about the port number 22, YYP. So I can uncomment this line and I can change the port number to 2222. And that means the port number 2222 will be allowed for SSH connection now. So that is why you can change the settings. If you want to make a different port connectivity from this, you can change that. I'm not changing it right now, but however, if you want, you can change the settings here. Same way, allow remote, generally we don't allow root user to connect from remote machines. And that settings also you will find here, allow remote login, root login is allowed or not. And you will see the setting in this file only. You see, password authentication allowed, permit and empty password, no. Right, the root settings also, let me check root. Yeah, here ch root directory. Okay, so we have some settings here related to allow super user or root user login. We will find the settings also in this file only for that root user connecting is allowed or not, whether normal you ignore ch host, known host. So many settings are there. We never make changes into this file as such. Default settings are good enough for us. Now this is SSH config, SSHD config, two files and connecting from remote machines and copying the files. From compute, I want to copy this file to some directory somewhere. I can use SSH SCP, secure copy. So now let's take a look at the session. The theoretical part of it. We have already done the practical aspect. Only these two commands are discussed in this session. Let's take a look at now. Red Hat Enterprise Linux install the SSH package by default. So it is default. By default it is always installed, as I said. And TCP port number 22 is open from the firewall also. There is no control. It is not protected. Because if it is protected, you will not be able to access your own machine also. You might have configured. So that is the reason this is also, security is also enabled on this port. Related configuration files are stored into etc SSH directory. You have seen that. I just show you that file. etc ssh ssh underscore config and sshd underscore config file. Secure shell daemon is secure because it encrypts the messages. Users who are listening on a network cannot read the data sent between SSH client and servers, and that's the important on public networks such as internet, because you must encrypt the data to protect yourself from attacks. RHEL incorporates SSH version 2, which supports multiple key exchange methods. The file, main configuration file as a client. As a client means we are trying to connect from our machine to some other machine. So when we are at the receiving end, we are client. So what are the settings? Where the client settings are stored? I have just showed you this file, etc. SSH SSH underscore config file. We have seen that file. In this file, the first directory was a host star. That means this allows other directories to all connections. This is followed by a directory that support authentication using generic security service application programming interface GSSAPI for client server authentication So this basically provide us a very interesting and very secure authentication method, which is called Kerberos authentication. And this is for that this file, this line was there. And after that there were few environment variables. If you notice that one more line was there, in fact forward X11 trusted. This basically means this support the GUI applications. X11 is legacy reference to X Windows system. Mind it is X Windows system, not Windows system. S is not there, and don't think that is typo. It is absolutely correct. X Windows system server used on Linux. So for to connect to that X Windows system, and next are some environment variables. So these are environment variables. We never get into these variables because they are normally trivial between two Red Hat Enterprise Linux systems, so we never interfere in that. So that's all. You literally don't have to make changes, any changes in this file. Just for your understanding, I'm discussing it. You don't require, even if you forget that what was there in the file, I'm okay with it, because even I have never used these files. But yes, I know that this file exists. I know there's some settings in this file, and for past so many years I've been working, but I have never configured anything in this file. How to access it? We have already done that. SSH username @ hostname, and this is what we tried. We directly also tried SSH with the IP address. SSH followed by 10.0.0.31, and we connected to the controller compute node from this IP address, because this IP address was the compute node. Command line access. So if you get error such as none name or service not known when you attempt to access a remote host via SSH, that indicate the system cannot resolve the host name to an IP address. Because if you are trying to use the host name rather than your IP address, remember you can use host name or you can use IP address, you can use both, but host name must be resolvable. If your host name is not resolvable, you should understand the meaning of term resolve. Resolve means there's a mapping of IP address to the host name. Like when you type google.com, google.com actually there's a server with some IP address, and resolve means google.com should map to the corresponding IP address where google.com is hosted. That term is known as resolve. So if you are not able to resolve a domain name to the host to the IP address, then you will get this kind of error, that name or service not known. In that case you need to log into the machine and using the IP address, not the host name. Right, like this, you know, if you know the host name, you can connect using the host name. SSH -l means the username, so you can use @ or -l, one and the same thing. Like you can use SSH root @ server.example.com or SSH -l root space server1.example.com. It is same thing. Without the username, SSH command will assume that you are logging in the remote machine as the username on the local machine, which I showed that if you don't use the username, you simply specify the host name or the IP address, then on remote machine, that would mean you are trying to connect as the user which you have logged in on your local machine. Like on your local machine, on the client machine, if you are logged in as SangOne user and you don't use the username to connect to the remote machine, that means on the remote machine you will be connecting as SangOne user only. So it will be mapping will happen. SangOne on local, that means SangOne on remote. Root @local means root remote machine. So that basically, if you don't specify this detail, if you don't specify these, if you specify this, then it is okay, then it is best thing. So for example, if you were to run a command SSH server1.example.com, now what will be the user ID on the server1.example.com depend on what you are logged in on the local machine. So if you try this command from the user SangOne account, The SSH command assume that you are trying to log in to the server1.example.com system as user Sangwan. You are logged into Sangwan on a local system, so it will take it as you are trying to log in to the remote machine also as user Sangwan. The first time the command is run between the system, it presents something similar to the following message. You notice this message: the authenticity is not, or the, you know, cannot be established. Then a warning key, right? Warning permanently added when you type yes. And you remember first time you got this warning, this kind of message, and we noticed that yes, it was there. When we selected yes, then it was added to the known host file, the file which was created under .ssh folder. So once connected via SSH, you can do anything on that machine that's supported by your user privileges on that machine. Let me show you what we can do. So here I'm working on compute machine, and this is the best thing, power off. You know, the machine is being shut down now. You see the compute machine, controller machine, compute. It is being shut down and is going away, because you have power it off, and it will go away now. Power off, gone. You see, the machine is gone. That machine is now power off. So from remote, you can even reboot, restart, and power off, whatever you want to do that machine. I'm starting again because we need to do more commands on this. Let me share my screen. I missed that screen share again, and Obi this time did not remind me. Obi, you should have informed me that your screen is not shared. I just tried without talking, you know. Let me show you. I just shared the screen now again. Hopefully you are seeing the screen now. So let's connect and let's see the effect of this remote access. I'm connecting myself to the controller machine. Take a look at controller machine. Now it is okay, right? Screen is not coming. I just shared the screen. One second. Now it is okay, I think. Now you see? Okay. So, see, now I'm working on the controller machine. Right? So, I can even do power off. I just wanted to show you. I'm rebooting the machine. Reboot. And the reboot will happen. So, from SSH, you can even power off the machine. And you see the controller machine is going now. You see the controller machine is being powered off. Now you see it is running, but it is being powered off and it is rebooting the machine. And that you will see from here. Controller, now it is running, but it is being powered off. And let me show you that compute also. I'll do the same thing for compute machine also. I'm logging in an SSH. Opening the connection. Keep watching this controller because it is being powered off. It will be rebooted. And I'm showing this machine also. Root. Red Hat. And same way I'm doing reboot for this machine also. Reboot. And now this machine also will go away and will be rebooted. You see, keep watching. It will be powered off and it will be rebooted. You see, the controller machine is being started again, rebooted. Same way, look at this machine also. Just wait, and this machine also will be rebooted. So meaning is simple. You can control every aspect of the machine. You can do anything and everything on the remote machine if you have SSH access. And why to talk more, I'll tell you, I have my own production server, you know it. So I manage through all those servers using SSH only. There's no other alternative. I use them, I manage them through my SSH. And that's why, if you notice, there were so many connections of SSH on my PuTTY, because I use them to connect to my remote servers. So for example, you can even shut down the remote system gracefully with power of command. And I demonstrated power off and reboot. More SSH command line tools. If you prefer to access a remote system with an FTP like client, then we have SFTP command. FTP means file transfer protocol. You want to transfer some files from one machine to another. Although hyphen L switch does not have the same meaning of SSH command, it still can be used to log into the account for any user on the remote system. Whereas regular FTP communication proceeds in the clear text, the communication with the SFTP command can be used to transfer file in encrypted format. I have not used it, but you can figure out, you can try this command after installing it, FTP, SFTP, SSH command line tools, SCP, which I demonstrated, copy files. If you notice, I copied one file from my local machine to the remote machine by specifying the host name followed by colon sign followed by directory, if you remember that correctly. So to transmit the file, as an example, sample.sh to one of your system, we can use a command similar to the following from the local directory to the remote system with no